Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 12th February 2019. The articles we'll be seeing for prelims are these four. First article talks about the adoption of children in India. This is a data according to NGO for the period 2015 to 2018, and this trend shows that there are more female adoption when compared to males. Second and third article talks about the places in news. Second is about the country of Thailand, and the third article is about the country of Japan. The final article for the day is Sustainable Development Goal India Index and the Base Report 2018 released by Niti Aayog. The first article for the day is 60% children adopted in India between 2015 and 2018 are girls. This article was taken from the paper Hindu, and this data stands in contradiction to the child sex ratio and a normal sex ratio prevalent in our country. We all know that in India there is still preference of patriarchy and thus the preference of son. So the Economic Survey 2017 describes this as meta-son concepts, and this results in the prevalence of female infanticide and even early child marriages with respect to women. This is manifested via the data also. According to Census 2011, the sex ratio in our country is 940 females per 1000 males, and the child sex ratio is even worse. There is only 914 female childs when compared to 1000 male childs. However, one important recently released figure, as per Child Adoption Resource Information and Guidance System under Ministry of Women and Child Development, shows that 60% of the children adopted in our country between the year 2015 and 18 are girls. Why is this so? One possible reason for this phenomenon is, since more sons are preferred, more female children are put for adoption, thus more female children are adopted. So this trend is both for inter-country as well as intra-country adoptions. Another possible reason for this trend is urban middle class people, they prefer female children over the male children because they are concerned about the social phenomenon of patriarchy, and the awareness in them prefers them to adopt a girl child over a boy child. For prelims, we also have to know about the authority called as CARA, that is Central Adoption Resource Authority. This Central Adoption Resource Authority is a statutory body established under Juvenile Justice Act. And this autonomous body, it functions under Ministry of Women and Child Welfare. This is the only body in our country which is responsible for both inter-country as well as intra-country, that is within India as well as outside India, adoptions belonging to the children of India. And more about this organization, this is an autonomous body functioning under Women, Ministry of Women and Child Development, and it is responsible for both inter- and intra-country adoptions. So the main objective of establishing this body is establishing affectionate and caring family, and this body has been established as India is a signatory to Hague Convention of Inter-Country Adoptions, and this authority has been mandated according to the provision of Hague Convention of Inter-Country Adoption. This authority, apart from facilitating adoptions, it also provides financial assistance to various NGOs and government homes to ensure that quality child care is ensured for the children in our country. The second article we'll be seeing is places in news, the country of Thailand. This country is in news because of a few political decisions taken in the country. One of the member of the royal family was nominated for the prime ministerial elections in our country, and that decision was heavily criticized. For prelims, if you study any country, you have to know about the geography of the country and also the international organizations the country is part of. So now the country in news is Thailand. So Thailand, its capital is Bangkok. So let's begin with the geography of Thailand. Thailand is bordered by four countries, namely Cambodia, Laos, Burma or Myanmar, and here it is bordered by Malaysia. It also has innumerous water bodies surrounding it. So this water body is called as Gulf of Thailand. Gulf is a water inlet surrounded by land, and this is a Sea of Andaman. And Indian Union territory of Andaman Nicobar also lies at a close proximity to Thailand. This area is called as isthmus. An isthmus is a geographical feature wherein a small thin piece of land separates two larger land areas. So here this isthmus is called as isthmus of Kara, K-R-A. This isthmus of Kara separates mainland Thailand with Malay Peninsula here. There are also many other numerous water bodies here. This is Mekong River. This Mekong River almost flows through many countries in Southeast Asia, including Thailand. And this Mekong River, it forms the border between Laos and Thailand. If you see from international organizations' perspective, Thailand and India, they form a part of many organizations. First important organization which Thailand is part of is ASEAN. ASEAN is in news because this year is 25th anniversary of ASEAN, and there is more probability of questions coming from ASEAN area. So ASEAN consists of 10 countries including Thailand. India and Thailand is also a part of ongoing multi-million dollar projects called as India-Myanmar-Thailand Trilateral Highway. So this trilateral highway, it connects India to Thailand via Myanmar. So in India, a town called as Moray in the state of Manipur is connected to a town called as Mahe Sot here to Thailand. And this connectivity project will increase the connectivity of northeastern states to eastern part of the world. Thus, it is in accordance to the Look East policy as well as Act East policy of India. Apart from this, India and Thailand are also part of many innumerable regional organizations such as BIMSTEC, Bay of Bengal Initiative for Multisectoral and Technical Cooperation, which includes South and Southeast Asian countries as part of it. Another organization called as Indian Ocean Rim Association, which includes the countries in Indian Ocean region. And the larger organization such as Asia Cooperation Dialogue, which was formed in the year 2002, which is an intergovernmental organization to help integrate various organizations such as BIMSTEC, SAARC, SEO, GCC among the Asian countries. The next article we'll be seeing is another places in news, the country of Japan. This country was in news because of the cherry blossom season called as Sakura, which is currently happening in the country. So here also, first let's start with geography. If you see geography of Japan, it is made up of large number of island groups. The important island groups are four in number. First island group in the top is called as Hokkaido Island. Second is Honshu Island, third is Shikoku, and fourth is Kyushu Island. And in this Kyushu Island is only Nagasaki present, and in Shikoku Island, Hiroshima is present, where nuclear bombs were dropped during the World War period. So another important place here is Fukushima, which is located in Honshu Island. This Fukushima is a place where infamous nuclear reactor attack happened in the year 2011, and it caused serious environmental damage. So Japan is surrounded by sea in all the sides. On its right, it has Pacific Ocean, and on its left, it has Sea of Japan, which is also called as East Sea. On its south, it has two seas, East China Sea as well as Philippine Sea. And on its north, it has Sea of Okhotsk. And near the Sea of Okhotsk, there are a series of small islands which is in dispute with Japan as well as Russia. And Japan is also part of Ring of Fire, which is due to plate tectonics. Since Japan is geographically located on the plate boundaries of converging and diverging plates, Japan is highly prone to earthquakes as well as volcanoes. Because of earthquakes and volcanoes, tsunamis can also occur in this area. Environmentally speaking, there are very important summits which have taken place in cities of Japan. First important city is called the city of Kyoto. We all know about the Kyoto Protocol of United Nations Framework on Climate Change. This is a very famous protocol which was signed in the year 1997, and it came into force in the year 2005. And this is a very important protocol as it aims to reduce the greenhouse gases such as CO2, oxides of nitrogen, methane, hydrofluorocarbons, perfluorocarbons, sulfur hexafluoride. These six greenhouse gases are included under this Kyoto Protocol, thereby reducing the global warming. Okay, this convention is not in force now, and it was effective only till the year 2012. And after the period of 2012, we now have sustainable development goals from the year 2015. Another important place is Nagoya. In Nagoya, a famous convention on biological diversity happened in the year 2010. So this convention on biodiversity in Nagoya is the follow-up of Cartagena Protocol on biological diversity. This 2010 agreement, it aims to create fair and equitable share of benefits arising out of the utilization of biological resources, and thus it aims to preserve the biological diversity, in a sustainable manner. Another important place is Sendai. Sendai is a place where Sendai Framework for Disaster Risk Reduction was adopted in the year 2015 under United Nations framework. And this is the only functional disaster management framework currently existing for the period 2015 to 2030. The final article for the day is taken from Hindu editorial part. In this article, we'll be seeing the prelims perspective of the editorial SGD India Index Baseline Report 2018 released by Niti Aayog. So let's begin with the basics. What are sustainable development goals? So as we saw in the previous year, in the year 2012, which calls for reduction in the greenhouse gases came to end. So after the period of 2012, the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change met in the year 2015 in the place called as Paris and drafted a new agreement called as Paris Agreement, which not just talks about the climate change, but it talks about other areas including poverty eradication, human health, urban settlement, safeguarding global ecosystems and even humanity for both developing as well as developed countries. So totally this has 17 goals and 169 targets. All these targets will overall help to create a better world where no one is left behind. This whole sustainable development goal is a part of transforming the old world agenda by the year 2030. And this Paris Agreement, it came into force in the year 2016, January 1, and India is a signatory to this agreement. For both prelims and main, we have to know about the sustainable development goals, all 17 goals. So the goal number one is to end poverty in its all form. Second goal is to ensure healthy lives for all ages. Third talks about gender empowerment and gender equality, especially for women and girls. And other important goal also talks about climate change, consumption pattern, energy pattern, life on earth, life below earth, urbanization and inclusive development. So these are the sustainable development goals with its numbers. So since India is a signatory to this agreement, India along with some other countries has planned to release a baseline report on the path of achieving the sustainable development. On India, this report is released by an organization called as Niti Aayog. And Niti Aayog has been designated as a nodal organization for the sustainable development in our country. Apart from Niti Aayog, other organizations such as Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation also makes a contribution for achieving sustainable development index from the data front. So Indian Sustainable Development Baseline Report, which was released in the year 2019, it adopts only 13 parameters out of all 17 parameters. Goal number 12, 13, 14 and 17 are left out since there is no proper data available on these goals. In the future years, these may also be included in the baseline reports. Based on the achievements of these 13 parameters, all 29 states are ranked in our country. So how are these states ranked? So these states are ranked based on 62 priority indicators. And how are these priority indicators chosen? So they are chosen based on the SGD relevance targets, based on availability of data, and also according to the consent given by various states as well as ministries. In the year 2018, the states were ranked into three categories. One is called as achievers, those who perform really well. And the second group is called as top performers. Third category is called as aspirants. Under achievers, the top performing states include Himachal Pradesh, Kerala and Tamil Nadu. Under top performers, states like Goa, Gujarat and Karnataka are included. And states like Assam, Bihar and UP with high population are under the category of aspirants, which means that more work is to be done to achieve the Sustainable Development Goal target. So in what way this index is useful? So this index will definitely support all the states as well as union territories to make progress for achieving national targets. So since this targets, it's wide ranging from poverty to gender equality, including health, education, as well as climate change. Implementation of this targets is very much necessary for creating a new India as well as better India. These targets also help identify the priority areas and so that proper channelized investments can be made in the targeted areas to show incremental progress. So with the availability of this data, the gaps can be identified using the statistical systems, and various welfare schemes can be targeted towards these gaps in order to address the issues. However, this index is not without its limitation. First limitation is 4 goals are left out. The 4 goals are goal number 12, which talks about reasonable consumption and production. 13 is climate action. 14 is life below water. And 17 is partnership for achieving these goals. These 4 goals, which even touches upon climate action, is very important for achieving sustainable future. Without including these 4 goals, quality of life cannot be ensured. And another important limitation is indicators emerging from state schemes are not included because of lack of availability of data. And as we all know, there is high regional disparity in our country. For example, state like Kerala fares high when compared to human development parameters when compared to UP or Bihar, which fares relatively poor. So state schemes will also be included to make the index more progressive. Thank you.